Thanks, John. So we're beginning to get a feel for this step seven and some of the dynamics involved in it. What I'd like to do now is talk to you a little bit in reference to Jesus's words as for the message. What I'm going to do is introduce you to the scripture, read the scripture, and then talk a bit in general terms about Jesus's message here and what he's after. And then we'll look at specifically this idea of humility as it pertains to step seven. So the context for today's reading is Jesus is now in Jerusalem during the Passover. There's a bounty out on his head by the religious greats of his time. The Pharisees and others have been conspiring together to get Jesus killed. And he comes into Jerusalem and is now in what we're about to read. He begins this long attack on those who are in positions of religious power and authority. And it's as if he's saying, you know, he's just making the target bigger on himself. But he's this is his opportunity to really challenge religion as it had become in his time, specifically for the Jewish faith, but also to begin to say something new is on the horizon. What I am about to do will be a lot different than what you have been used to and what, you know, honestly is not working. So he's attacking the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the scribes, and these are like the lawyers, the Supreme Court judges, the rulers of the temple that keep temple cult, and he's touching on all of what they're about, and he's getting himself in trouble because of it, but he also offers an alternative, and you'll hear that in this scripture that I'm going to read now from Matthew 23, and it's the 8th verse through the 12th verse. He says here, "Don't let anyone call you rabbi, for you have only one teacher, and all of you are equal as brothers and sisters. And don't address anyone here on earth as father, for only God in heaven is your father. And don't let anyone call you teacher, for you have only one teacher, the Messiah. The greatest among you must be a servant. But those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted." So you hear in that message, he's saying, don't do these things. And he's saying, because this is what's true on the other side of that. You know, you've heard me say oftentimes when I introduce myself, I say, my name's Brad. I'm one of the ministers here at Recovering Love Church. And I take that because of what Jesus just said here. You know, pastor's a nice title, or reverend, or maybe father, or whatever. But Jesus, what he was saying here is that, in effect, all of us are plagiarists when it comes to religion. I mean, we have one teacher, it's God. We have one father, it's God. We have one teacher, it's the Messiah. And he says, because all of you are brothers and sisters. All of you are this way before me. And when I think about the importance of this step, why do we do this, the seven-step prayer? What's implied in that prayer? So I can better serve my fellows and you. And in effect, what Jesus is getting at is not only a personal call to humility, but also he's actually saying that the system itself is going to be changed about what it means to be right with God. When you have the system that the Jewish faith was about, was there were hierarchies. And Jesus is saying, no, there's not going to be that anymore. And unless you humble yourself, the greatest will become what? A servant. And he's saying, those up here, we want you to move down here. Those down here, though, We want you to move up here. You know, those that are exalted will be humbled. Those who are humbled will be exalted. And the hope is that we'll somehow end up here. And I call that space the grace space, where each of us knows we, at times we feel like we're up here, but more often we feel like, if you're like me, down here, lower than most and struggling. Or I failed God. I didn't live up to what I know to be true about my Christian faith and the walk. But in this, Jesus is saying, you know, God is going to do the lifting and God is going to do the humbling. That it's really, and that's what we ask of this step, don't we? We humbly ask that God remove what may be falsely exalting us, or maybe, God, would you elevate what I feel is a deficit, so that we can be together in this beautiful space we call the Christian community, or the community of recovery, where I remember Dick Rice used to say, he was quoting some other person who said, you know, in AA, we're all the same size. Because, you know, we're all equally humbled. If we live long enough in this program, whether it's our addiction that humbles us or our inability to do the steps to perfection, both have a way of kind of leveling us, you know. And it's like you get some years like Scott, you know, 21 years. But I know Scott will tell you, just like anybody who's been around a while, like John, that the longer you're in it, the more humbled you become, because you realize it isn't about drinking and drugging. It's about seeking this spiritual solution that is about the power of God, not our own. When I try to do my own program, you know, I'm so right, and nobody wants to be around me. You know that one? God, get away, you know? But then there's those that John said, you know, about Paul. He was quoting, I think, Paul about, you know, when someone's humble, it's attractive. There's something that says that person's approachable. That person is living in the truth. That person is right-sized. And there's something attractive and appealing and right about the way that person is living their spiritual life and their relationship with God and others that I'm attracted to. So you see in this idea of, you know, I mean, I have to admit, when I was first ordained, I had a robe. I would wear a robe and all that stuff, and I was never comfortable in it. And the title now of pastor and stuff, I'm not that comfortable with that either, because I know you, and I know what it is to be alcoholic. I know what it is to be arrested. I know what it is to do jail time. I know what it is to make my kids really, really sad and awfully alone. I know what it is to want to stop drinking and not be able to, even though I believe in God and I'm a Christian. I know what it's like to be leveled by alcoholism. And because of that, I recognize how grateful I am to be a part of what we are a part of. Because none of us belong here, but all of us do belong here. You know, that's the beauty of this humility thing in step 7 is God says, I know, but let me show you how much I love you. How else are we going to get better? If it's about being right, forget it. And that's what I think Jesus was saying. You know, good luck on that righteous, that self-righteous thing, obeying all those laws. Give it a try, but it's not going to work for you, and it doesn't work for a system of being religious, of being one. Another friend of the program says, I was seeing my spiritual director, and they said, well, as long as you're competitive, you can't be compassionate. And if the system is competitive, like there are people who are more spiritual or more right than others, how can we be compassionate? You're a threat to my spirituality. I've got to one-up you or I'm not right. And Jesus said, we're going to put that to bed. I'm about something that's much more. It's for all of you. It's like the woman when he approached the woman at the well, and she was there during the heat of the day because people didn't want to associate with her. She was not right. And she had to go when nobody else would be there because she was unclean. And Jesus is there to meet her. And she goes, you know, what are you doing asking me for some water? We don't associate. You're up here. I'm way down here. Jesus said, if you knew who I am, you know, you'd get me some water. And they have these conversations, and he tells her, you know, you have a bunch of husbands. He knows all about her. And she's like, first of all, she's really put off by that. And then he tells her, though, and he goes, I know you can't get anywhere near the temple because of who you are. You can't even get close to this well if anybody who's clean is here. He's going, let me tell you something, though. There will be a day when you will worship in truth and in spirit. Welcome. And I think without humility, we won't know grace. And without getting in touch with this system and saying, maybe there's another way. Maybe it isn't about being right. Maybe it's about being humble and understanding, yep, me too. I need grace today. There's a couple of things that are indications of spirituality, this process of being humbled when you feel exalted. And it was sent to me this week, and I thought it was really fitting. And I'll see if I can enlarge it and read it to you, just a section of it, because I don't know, most of us, there's that feeling of being humiliated, which isn't fun. Those who are exalted get humiliated. It happens to me quite frequently because I refuse to be humble. That's the way it is. But this author coined a term that he found from a Polish psychologist named Kazimierz Dąbrowski, who talks about this idea of positive disintegration. Positive disintegration. And he says, ancient myths talk about the need sometimes to descend into the underworld, to live in the darkness for a while, to sit in ashes so as to move to a deeper place inside of life. The mystics talk about dark nights of the soul as being necessary to bring about maturity. Ignatius of Loyola teaches that there is a place for both consolation and desolation in our lives. The philosopher Carl Jaspers suggests that the journey to full maturity demands that we sometimes journey in the norm of night, not just in the norm of the day. And the Jewish scriptures assure us that certain deep things can only happen to the soul when it is helpless and exposed in the desert or the wilderness, and that sometimes, like Jonah, we need to be carried to some place where we'd rather not go, in the dark belly of the whale. And perhaps most challenging of all, we see that Jesus was only brought to full compassion through sweating blood in Gethsemane and then dying a humiliating death on the cross. All of these images point to the same deep truth. Sometimes in order to grow, we must first fall apart, go into the dark, lose our grip on what's normal, and enter a frightening chaos, and lose our everyday securities and be carried in pain to a place where, for all kinds of reasons, we weren't ready to go on our own. And I think that is humility lived when the old system and the old way of doing life for us, even if it's trying to be Christian, stops working. And we begin to lose control and we enter into this chaos of this wilderness experience where what we knew and the system we lived in and abided by begins to fall apart, and we enter into something new and something mysterious and something like the love of God, which catches us in those times when what we know is falling apart. Lastly, I want to talk just about humility from the point of spirituality of imperfection. And it's just a really nice little treatise on the idea of humility. And the author writes this: "For the words human, humor, and humility all have the same root. The ancient word gom, best translated by the English, humus. And humus, or is what they describe as, it's a brown-black substance resulting from the partial decay of plant and animal matter." So this decaying of our lives, humus, you think of what happens when it, what it means to be able to laugh at ourselves, or to be really, really human, but and yet be seen as spiritual, that those who've done the hard work of falling apart and yet finding God in the bottom, in the abyss, in the loss, in the messiness, in the wreckage, that those people who are able to laugh at themselves because it, that has been healed. And that becomes, as we say in the ninth step, no matter how down, how far down the scale we've gone, we will see how our experience can help another person. But I love the idea that to be human and to be full of humor and to be humble or is all from that root. And I just think that's really telling. And so as we will be sharing the seven-step prayer shortly, I want us to think about what it is we're praying when we do that prayer, when we pray to our Creator, and we ask God to have all of us, the whole of ourselves, good and bad, and that we begin to ask God to remove from us those defects, those unused things that don't help us love God and others better, that we ask for strength and for God to work through our lives that we may better do God's will this day. So I'm glad to be on this step, and my prayer is for all of us that we as a church can continually be on this step together, that we can live in that freedom as equals, as brothers and sisters in grace, brothers and sisters who are on the road to progress, not perfection, those of us who can love each other through the hard times, through those wilderness moments, and that we together can be for each other the grace that God has shown us in Jesus Christ. Amen.